welcome to Tuesday Night Live, the big gig. This is our second big show. If you haven't seen the show before, don't worry, we'll be gentle with you. It's great to be here. I'm feeling really great tonight, actually, because I've just given some money to a charitable organisation, and that always does make you feel good. I've just given some money to Jim and Tammy Baker. No, come on, there's a lot of dirty talk about these guys. I love Jim and Tammy, you know, because they're really honest about their message, right? What they say is, give us your money or rot in hell for eternity. I mean, what could be simpler than that? It's really direct, you know. And you'd have to be either American or stupid, and believe me, the two terms aren't mutually exclusive, to give them some money. Do you know how much money they got for Praise the Lord Ministry? $9 million. It's incredible. Well, as Jimmy Baker says, you know, the Lord does not want his people to go second class. I suppose that's why God insisted that Mary go first class on the donkey. Makes you wonder what second class was, doesn't it? Like a pig with arthritis or something. But I love, the one thing that I really love was Jim Baker's excuse for having those affairs, you know. He said, the devil made me do it. No, Jim, it was your dick. You know? Just a small thing, Jim, really, but there is a bit of a difference, right? Like the devil, prince of darkness, lives in hell. That pink, wrinkly thing that hangs out your underpants, that's your grandmother. No. I'm easy. That's your dick, you know. But you know, you know when you give money to Jim and Tammy, you know where the money's going to go. It's not going to go to some charitable organisation. It's going to pay for call girls and Kajal pencils. I mean, let's face it, if you've seen Tammy, what a makeup bill that woman must run up. Now I know what a poke in the eye with a burnt stick really means. But you see, it's not Jim and Tammy that really worry me. The people who really bother me are those New Age believers, right? They're really insidious and they're all over the place. They could be here tonight and you wouldn't even know. Like, you'd know if Tammy Baker was in the room because you'd be able to hear her makeup creaking and subsiding. You know, like when continental plates sort of shift and grind against each other. But New Age believers are everywhere. I was chatting to a friend of mine the other day and, you know, we were chatting away and I said to her, you know, I seem to be a bit low energy at the moment. I can't seem to get much done. And she said, you know, have you had your numerology charts done? Because it could mean you're entering a low energy cycle. And I don't know how many of you have seen that film, The Body Snatchers, but it's like, it's like they take your real friends away and replace them with people who look like your real friends and sound like your real friends, but they've got this sort of glaze around the eyes. And it's really quite nasty stuff, you know. We were talking away, she said, you know what your problem is? It's positive visualisation. If you're not getting what you want out of life, it means you're just not putting out the right vibes. And I thought, this is something that several million starving Africans should be fairly interested in. This is obviously where Bob Geldof went wrong. I mean, he should have enrolled all those Ethiopians in EST classes, you see. So anyway, she decided to give me a lift and we're sitting in the car and I said, look, what's that on the dashboard? And she said, that is a crystal to help me tap into the world's energy grid. And I said, gee, I thought they were called spark plugs. Anyway, by then I'm starting to positively visualise myself walking home. So I can see what she means. I mean, you know, crystals are so much more aesthetically pleasing, aren't they? I mean, you don't want to go to a herb vinegar bottling wearing a spark plug round your neck, do you? Anyway, we're travelling along, you know, not astral travelling, just, you know, the ordinary kind. And she said, do you know something else? In a previous life, I was a witch who was burnt at the stake. And I thought, oh, no, I can't stand this. Because now amongst my friends, I've actually got four witches who were burnt at the stake. One Greek warrior, a Roman senator, and a Minoan priestess. I mean, now let's think about this logically, okay? Given that there's been a population explosion, right? You're keeping up? That's more people than there used to be for the non-technically minded. Doesn't this mean that some people aren't going to get a past life? And unless you get in quickly, all the really good ones are going to be gone. You're going to find out that you were maybe a haberdasher from Canberra who died by tripping over a rubbish bin. Let's face it, that's not very trendy, is it? You know, I think I've got more in common with ordinary Australians who believe in alcohol and sport. I mean, come on, what's the use of having a past life when you're too pissed to remember chunks of the one you got now? All from me from now, but do you know, I want to tell you something, did you know that a person once said that a flamenco dancer is just a Spaniard trying to get a glimpse of his own ass? You know what I mean? but Spanish music is more than that, isn't it? I mean, it's hot, sweaty rhythms, it's exciting, it makes your blood really run hot. Let's face it, it was the original dirty dancing. And I'd like to introduce you now to the dirtiest band I know, Kenny Lopez, Sex Mambo.
Update. Police today denied responsibility for the latest black death in custody. We did everything we could to raise their self-esteem, said a spokesman. Macrame classes, tug of war, Indian rope tricks. We gave them every facility. Police have also explained the alleged suicide of a white constable. Apparently the officer had recently transferred from the traffic branch and succumbed to a desperate attempt to reach his quota. And now, back to the program. Remember when the ABC generally had something nice on of an evening? Something with frocks.
very fine comedian and a dead set top spunk to boot. Unfortunately, we don't have anyone like that on the show, so here's Glyn.
Thank you. Thank you, Wendy, you old hag. Anyway, good evening and great to be here. Look, tonight I want to talk about driving, talk about cars. You see, I drive a little van, actually, a little Suzuki Caravan. It's called a Suzuki Caravan because it's yellow and it's completely useless. Great little van, though. It's got four speed. It's got reverse, neutral, first, and this is as fast as I'm going, pal. Please don't hurt me. Great car, though. You see, as far as I'm concerned, I'm not really that much into cars. They're just vehicles designed to get you from A to B, as far as I'm concerned. But a lot of men, and I think a lot of the ladies watching will probably appreciate this, a lot of the men will try to impress women with the kind of car you drive. You've noticed this?
Yeah.
Especially if the guy sort of owns... thank you. If the guy owns a big, sort of long, red, sort of Porsche or something. And how often have you seen this at the disco, right? And there he is, dancing away. This is the medallion here. Hey, baby. Hey, come here. You know what I got? I got a Porsche. You want to come my place? Touch my Porsche? It doesn't work, guys. It doesn't work, because I've tried it. And hey, baby, you want to come back to my place and touch my Suzuki Caravan? It doesn't really work. But you see, women are not interested basically in the kind of car you drive. They're interested in things like tambourines that play in the background. And they're interested in things like the color of your hair, the texture of your voice, your sense of humor, how much money you have. What model is this Porsche? These are the things that are important. But you see, a lot of men get so carried away with it. And I've got a question for the guys, just for the guys. Listen, guys, just the guys. You knew when you were about 16 or 17 and you had your first car, and, right? You know, you see all kinds of things like shouting at people, "Oh, God, oh," that kind of thing, and the dog started to chase the car. Did you ever slow down just a little bit so that you can let the dog catch up level with the door? And then did you ever open the door quickly and smash it in the face? No? No one?
No, no one.
Neither did I, and I think anyone that's very cruel indeed. And my little van's great. It gets me around. And basically, cars, this is a fact, they're all designed to break down. They're all designed to break down, with the exception of one car. The Volvo. No. The Volvo's been specifically designed to look very plain and boring, and it is. And it's made in Sweden. And as you know, Swedes taste very much like parsnips, if you cook them in a nice little sauce pan. But the Volvo is the thinking man's car. So why? Why? Why are they all driven by dickheads?
Hello, I'm the Volvo driver. Come along, children, it's a nice, bright, sunny day. Let's go for a drive with our lights on.
The Volvo driver never has an accident, but he sees lots. For him, every day is a Sunday. And he's the guy who overtakes you on the freeway just to pull in front of you and slow down. But for me, my little van is good enough. It gets me around, you know. A lot of people say, "Where'd you get the van? In a cornflakes packet?" No, I did not. My girlfriend did. 800 cc's of throbbing power. Going up a hill. Get the top of the hill. I'm being overtaken by a little old lady. And she's walking. Top of the hill. Oh, flat tire. I ran over a milk bottle. I didn't see it. The stupid kid had it in his coat pocket. Oh, don't you just hate that? I left the handbrake on the whole time. Parking's a breeze. Oh, another Volvo. Sorry, mate.
Thanks, it was great. And now two guys who are regulars on the show. They're all the way from Perth. In fact, they're Laurie Connell's favourite customers, the Empty Pockets.
Comrades!
Brothers and sisters!
Abuse of power is a terrible thing.
Corruption in a position of responsibility cannot go unnoticed.
And we have noticed.
A lot!
People are placed in a position of trust by the people, for the people, and those people had their trust abused by other people.
Yeah, and you people just sit back and let these other people control your destiny.
And these people?
The ones that abuse the power.
They're all corrupt.
Well, not all of them.
Most of them are corrupt.
There are exceptions.
Many of them are very shifty indeed.
A lot of them are not that bad.
A few bad apples are spoiling it for everyone else.
Oh, one or two are very, very corrupt indeed, I'm sure of that.
And these little Hitlers are making control of the people, by the people, very difficult for the people.
When you least expect it, they'll pull out on you.
Never giving any indication where they're heading.
They never give way.
They're always there and never when you need them.
When they go right, the people want to go left.
You can never tell what they're going to say to you.
They're always imposing new tariffs and charges.
You ask them for a little help, a little time, a little direction, and they slam the door in your face!
They are the ultimate abusers of power!
Who are they, Matty?
Taxi drivers!
Catch the bus, driver!
Jason, can I have a wheatgrass juice, please? Thanks. You're not going to believe this, but I used to be totally obsessed with my body. Yeah, that was before I started working on my mind. And before that, my life is totally limited, you know. I'd get up in the morning, have a shower, get dressed into something, have breakfast, tea, toast and jam, go to work, have lunch, ham and salad sandwich, sometimes cheese and salad and a fruit juice, go back to work, finish work, go to the gym, work out for at least a while, go home, cook a quick and easy meal, beef shortcuts or lamb shortcuts or chicken shortcuts or grilled shortcuts, ring up a friend, talk about diet and watch TV, have some chocolate and go to bed. And then one morning I woke up and I thought to myself, something is missing in my life. And then I thought, maybe it's personality. And then I thought, no, it's not that simple. It's deeper than that. Maybe I need a colonic flush. And then it came to me like a blinding fog. Like, in my effort to be totally vibrant, healthy and intelligent, I'd lost sight of who I really was. I mean, what's the use of having a totally gorgeous body like Victoria Principal if you've got a mind like Victoria Principal? So, that's when I started my journey of self-discovery. You know, I started looking for myself and I was amazed just how much was missing. You know, the more I explored myself as a person, the more holes I found. Holes I never knew I had. So that's when I started working on my mind. You know, and like your brain, right? Your brain's not just something that's sort of grey and sloppy that you don't understand. No, it's actually very practical. I hadn't realised that. Yeah, I mean, your brain's like a big building, right? Oh, first of all, you know how there's a left side and a left side and right side? Well, actually, there's also a front side and a back side. Excuse me. And anyway, it's like a big building, you know? And at the back is like the offices where all the work's done, and the front's like the reception area. And most people function like there's a temp on the switchboard, you know? Like messages just don't get through. But when you start exercising your mind, what it does is makes the brain, it helps the brain, is my hair right? Oh yeah, good. It really helps you to concentrate, yeah. So anyway, and it really works, you know. A friend of mine walked up to me the other day and she said, Candida, that's my name. She said, Candida, you have changed so much. And I said, yes, Aphrodite. Since I have started self-improving, I'm living my life on a totally different level. And she said, oh, did you move to the flat upstairs? And I thought, uh-oh, there's no one in the lobby. And then I thought, no, come on, Candida, be fair. I mean, you know, remember there was a time when I was limited too. And so I said to her, why don't you do what I first did? And what I first did was an own your own life course. Because, yeah, I didn't even have a mortgage, you know? And that was totally fantastic. There was about 50 of us, and we were locked in a room for about 4 hours. And we all sat in a circle and we chanted, I am self-reliant. And it was really great. And when I came out, I felt really totally purged. Because I've been busting to go to the toilet for about 2 hours. And anyway, but it really helped me to sort of understand life better, and it made me an even more compassionate person, you know? Like, I know now that people are poor and ugly because they choose to be poor and ugly. I hadn't realised that, you know? And so if you want money, you'll get money. If you want money and don't get it, it means you really didn't want it. But if you want it and you do get it, it means you really did want it. And I want money, so now I'm going to get money. You see, all my life I have wanted to make something of myself. And now I'm going to have the money to buy the parts. Totally gorgeous. Yeah.
Thanks. Our next guest made quite a fuss in Edinburgh last year. Has anybody here been to Edinburgh? It's a beautiful place, full of historic buildings. It's lovely. Of course, in Australia, we would have pulled down all that old shit years ago, but it is great. The one thing that's great about going to Scotland is everywhere you go, there are fantastic tour guides who take you around, because the whole history of the place is sort of soaked in blood. There's always this tour guide saying, if you look down there, ladies and gentlemen, I actually don't know what nationality he was, but if you look down there, you'll see where 1,500 brave Scottish Highlanders had their arms hacked off by Sassernac bastards. And it's really great. I wonder what happens to tourists when they come here. It must be so boring. What does someone say? If you look down there, ladies and gentlemen, you'll see where Fred Brown and Manangatang backed over the wife in the ute in 56. Now, that's as interesting as it gets. Anyway, as I say, our next guest caused a huge fuss at Edinburgh and then went off to work in London, New York, Montreal. Still, doesn't make them any good. Here they are, the Doug Anthony All-Stars!
Of rap. We are faster than a speeding bullet, because we are higher than a kite.
Yeah!
Now. Oh, hey, do you like our legs?
Yeah!
Do you like our rags?
Yeah!
Do you want a party?
Yeah!
Are you really stupid?
Yeah!
Do you like our colors?
Colors! Okay, now get out of my way! Get out of my way!
I don't want to see you now. I don't want to see you here, boy. I don't want to see you here, boy.
Get out of my face, one.
You.
Nothing.
We are commies for Christ. Here's a song about dangerous sex and love. Hey, my tags don't him.
No need to shout.
I said, that's my name.
Don't wear it out.
Hey, you see me here? I'm burning hot. I'm a ditching hamburger because I got the lot. I got a bone the size of a Tyrannosaurus Rex. Only one thing, I want your sex.
My name is Tricky Ricky. If the situation's sticky, then I'm your man. I got a fan. I used to be a bricky. I play my guitar all the live long day. If you don't like that, you better walk this way.
Rock it, Tricky Ricky, gonna rock it to the left. Rock it, Tricky Ricky, gonna rock it to the right.
My name is Paul, and the best of all, doesn't mean your face like a can of mess. I'm a groove lick, love child, sing the verse. Mess with me, Lord, you're leaving a hearse.
One, two, three, bomb.
Your God is a nothing God, is a mealy mouth God, is a weak ass God. My God is a real tough God, is a straight line God, is a good old boy. Your God drinks peach nectar, eats bull fruit, cock fart out loud. My God, I'm Wrestle Khrushchev. Eats meat, farts with pride. Hey, hey, commies, but Christ. Hammers and sickles and the words not flesh, it's steel.
Commies, but Christ.
Cause he's the man who carved the lamb and made us feel.
Commies, but Christ.
I'm having a sexual fling with a red under my bed.
Oh,
drank too much Ulta wine,
it's blown off half my head. Take Mark,
take Mark,
take Christ,
take Christ,
take drugs.
Take Mark,
take Mark,
take Christ,
take Christ,
take drugs.
Repetition,
yo, yo.
Your God been around for too long, can't get down. He's an aging hippie,
hippie, skippy, skippy. God, hey,
commies, but Christ.
You'll
get some long knives to carve up these loaves and fish.
Commies, but Christ.
Support the cause or else
someone could get fish.
Commies,
but Christ,
say, for Christ,
say,
for Christ,
say.
The truth, the light, the way.
Bomb, bomb.
My God ain't risen.
No.
Cause he's sleeping in today.
Hey,
take
Mark,
take Mark,
take Christ,
take Christ,
take drugs.
Na 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 na.
Take Mark,
take Mark,
take Christ,
take Christ,
take drugs.
Jesus rocks the Kremlin, baby, commies.
For Coca-Cola. All right.
The Doug Anthony All-Stars. Now, people, eyes this way. Quickly, eyes this way. Oh, there's a couple of giggling Gerties out there. That sort of behaviour is just not on. It's just not on. Oh, I can't control these people. Tim, say something to them.
Hey! 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 Hey!
Paul, I settled down a lot of you people. Fun time, quit the bloody laughter out. Not a joking matter now, people. Fun time is over. Now, people of Australia, what has happened to us, eh? Where's that Australian spirit of kicking a fellow when he's down? Eh? Where's our national humour gone? Now, I remember when the space shuttle went down, people. You people out there had come up with a good half dozen jokes before the wreckage hit the water. Now, don't clap this. Don't clap this while I'm being angry at you. Now, Salman Rushdie has been in the news now for about 10 days. And you people haven't come up with one good joke. Oh, it's not good enough, people. Now, we've made up a couple of jokes ourselves, but remember, there's only three of us. And there's 14 million of you. Now get cracking and let's get the boot in.
Now, we've got a few now to get you people motivated.
Okay, here's the first. How many Salman Rushdies does it take to change a light bulb? Only one, but you've got to find him first.
Hey! What kind of car does Salman Rushdie drive? One that goes... What's the difference between Salman Rushdie and a dead man? Couple of weeks, tops.
What do you get if you cross the Ayatollah with a dingo? Nothing, nothing, nothing.
There are some things a dingo just won't do for you.
Okay, what goes black-white? Black, white, black, white, black, white. Hey? Salman Rushdie, disguised as a nun, falling down a staircase.
Yeah, not one of your best. About 10 years ago, Cat Stevens, that dirty, filthy, hippie scumbag who used to be a rock star, decided that he was going to become a Muslim. And about 3 days ago, Cat Stevens came out and said, "Bring me the head of Salman Rushdie." Cat, what's the matter with you, mate? Don't you remember singing Peace Train? Don't you remember morning has broken? Cat, it's not time to make a change. Just relax. Take it slowly.
You're still young. That's your fault.
There's so much you've got to go through.
Find a girl. Settle down. If you want, you can marry.
Yeah, and if you want, you can marry again.
If you want, you can marry again.
Yeah, you want, you marry again. That's part of your faith, isn't it, lucky bastard?
Salmon satanic versus sink, like the Ayatollah's breath. Those identical sentences have sentenced us to death. They burn 1,000 copies, cause the verses are a curse. But they ain't like the Nazis, cause they paid for them first. Now all of us have problems, and when the world turns nasty,
don't worry.
Be happy. Things could be worse. You could be Salman Rushdie. Cat Stevens on his peace train will take him to Tehran. And while they hack his hands off, the book goes number one. He wrote a little story about Islam, God, and sex. Now everybody wants the Salman that John West rejects. Now all of us have problems. And when the world turns nasty,
don't worry.
Be happy. Things could be worse. You could be Salman Rushdie.
Silence now, because we have the book in question right here in this studio. Now we're going to do a couple of readings from this book, and you can decide for yourselves whether it's going to be blasphemous, obscene, or whatever. Okay, just at random, page 311. He saw her standing there upon the sand dune, with one bound who was by her side, his hand tearing at the flimsy nightgown that... Oh, that's a bit rough. I'm sure there's something a bit nicer a bit further on. We'll just look. Here we go. 363, something about camels. The camel looked at him with large brown eyes. With one bound, he was by her side, his hand tearing the flimsy saddle from her back. Oh, that's not possible. Oh, no, that's a bit rough. That is, by jingo.
That's what the camel said.
Now all of us have problems, and when the world turns nasty,
don't worry.
Be happy. Thank Allah, you're not Salman Rushdie.
Anyone got a match?
Here is a further news update. A police spokesman has defended the policy of locking up all Aboriginals on site. You city people don't know what it's like up here, he said. We've got blacks wandering about in shorts and sandals drinking out of cans. We can't have them thinking they're as good as white folk. We'll return to our program in just a moment. Look, do you remember all those lovely programs the ABC used to run? Certain women. I adored that. It was always good for a little cry. My hanky was ringing wet, especially after that episode when Leslie told Sharon that Julia told her about Sally and Charles. I don't know how it ended. I had to go to the kitchen for a little sob. Now it's hardly worthwhile turning on, really. Bring back epilogue, I say.
And the winner, with a grand total of $3,220.31, Leanne McDonald.
I'd like to take this opportunity to thank all the wonderful people in the audience tonight who cared enough for others to make a donation. Thank you. I must say that it means a great deal to me personally, but more than that, to all the unfortunate people out there less fortunate than ourselves. I'd just like to say all the girls have been really wonderful. Oh, this is incredible. It's just like a dream. I just don't believe this is happening. And I would just like to say a big thank you to all the hard-working organisers of this Miss Charity Queen Quest of 1989, and a big, big thanks to Mastercut Butchers for sponsoring me. Thank you. People often ask me why I want to be a charity queen, and the reasons are varied and manifold. Firstly, I like meeting and helping people, and my hobbies are aerobics, jazz, ballet, horse riding and raging. Thank you. This isn't my first quest or anything. I've actually been going in quite a few. Like, when I was about 9, my mum entered me in the Miss Kmart personality quest, and I was lucky and fortunate enough to carry that off. And when I was about 14, my boyfriend entered me in the local drive-in in the Miss Chico Roll quest. And I won 24 Chico Rolls and a family ticket to see Herbie Rides Again. Since then, the whole family has been really brilliant. Like, they have all pitched in to help me. Like, Dad's converted the Greyhound trailer into a dressing room. And we travel all over Australia for the quest. And then there's Mum. Mum does my hair. Just like she was trained at Monsieur Maurice of Moree. And then there's Nana. And Nana has been really brilliant to me. Like, Nana sews all my gowns. And Nana sewed 150,000 sequins on my Miss Huon Valley Applefest frock. And I just want to say, Nana, that any of the money I make tonight goes straight towards your cornea transplant. Overall, I think this industry has a great deal to be proud of. I know it might not be the time to get political, but let's face it, if the government put in more money for training and equipment, we could be the best charity queen nation in the world. It's not easy being a charity queen. I myself know the heartache and the tragedy. Like, just last year, I overstretched myself and I came down with sash rash. Oh, come on, this isn't funny. Some girls who get sash rash never work again. I was lucky enough to be able to take time off to build up my tolerance to polyester, and I'm much better now. Finally, to all those girls who were involved in the Civic Centre tragedy last month, my deepest sympathies. But they did say the judge's decision was final, even if a whole bunch of hairy lesbians in overalls and wheelchairs rolled right onto the stage halfway through the secretary's speech. And they say we're holding disabled people up to ridicule. Well, no one cares about the ridicule I have to go through selling flowers down at the deaf school. You want to buy some flowers? I don't know why those girls just don't go home and shave under their arms. Sad to think that no one these days is safe from political terrorism. Thank goodness for supporters like Mr. Ian Sinclair, who, right round the country, personally gets behind as many girls as possible. Well, thank you all. I know this is going to be a wonderful year for me as I travel around our wide sunburnt brown land. And of course, as my trainer, Mrs. Angelucci, says, Leanne, tomorrow is the first day of the rest of your life. And in a way, I think that could be true. So thank you. I'm going to make you all very proud of me. Thank you very much.
Profile. With us in the studio tonight is the Chairman, Chief Secretary and President of the Soviet Union, Mr. Mikhail Gorbachev. Welcome. Thank you for sparing us some of your valuable time. Mr. Gorbachev, the Soviet occupation or invasion of Afghanistan has left that country in a state of chaos, wracked by civil war and with a million dead. Do you take responsibility for this?
No. Because, I'll tell you why. Because I One day when I was playing tennis with my friend, Richard, and I played tennis with him, and he hit the ball like that, poink, and I went like that, poink, and the ball, and this is true, the ball went poink like that, miles away, and I said, oh, I better get the ball. And my friend Richard said, well, it's gone a long way. And I said, where'd it go? He said, Afghanistan. So I said, I'll get it. And he said, well, you better take a tank with you.
But surely there was more than one tank, wasn't there?
Yeah, we took about 100.
I think there was more than 100, really, wasn't it?
Well, about... probably, yes, probably. But I wasn't in all of them. I went in one.
Just to get a tennis ball. But what about all those millions of little babies who had their arms blown off?
I didn't know. I didn't do that one. I didn't, because what happened was I my friend said, go through over there, and I said, don't go near, there might be little children, and there was, and one of them got hit and crushed, and we picked it up and said, oh, this one's, and I threw it away.
I think on that note, we might throw open the questioning to the audience. Is there anyone in the audience here who'd like to perhaps ask Mr. Gorbachev a question? Yes, sir. Mr. Gorbachev, why have you stopped everyone in your country from drinking vodka?
Because they don't like it anymore. And you can have vodka. You can have vodka, but you're not allowed to drink it.
Fine. Any others? Yes, there's one up the back. Yes.
Mr. Gorbachev, is it true about your son, the American sailor?
Yes, because my son, he had a little American sailor that's that big, and he said, oh, what should I do with this American sailor? He said, I don't know, throw it away. So he threw it away, and it went boink like that. And everyone said, is that true? And he said, no. And I said, yes, it is. Don't you worry about that. And it was.
I think we better just finally ask you, you've offered a continued policy of disarmament with the West. Is this a trick?
Yes. The big trick.
Thank you. I think we'll just about wind it up there.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Listless and bored.
Snapping at your friends.
Falling behind at work.
Missing out on the weekend fun.
Maybe it's just not your month.
Well then, wrap yourself around Oz Comfy Pads.
Oz Comfy Pads, built tough for Aussie conditions.
They'll give you a confident, energetic lifestyle you've never dreamed of.
Go bareback horse riding.
And you like the judo?
Frolic at the beach.
Frolic, frolic, frolic. Ride the wild surf.
Maybe just relax in front of the telly.
Oz Comfy Pads' unique steel velvet design makes them ideal for a million uses.
Hey, stop those annoying drafts around the house.
Soundproof the kids' playroom.
Hey, insulate the house for winter.
Make them into a patchwork quilt.
This is the scientific test that proves Oz Comfy Pads are thicker than other brands on the market.
Buy Oz Comfy Pads now and be in the running for our Cover Up Down Under contest.
Just tell us in 25 words or less how Oz Comfy Pads have changed your life.
And you could win a 4-week trial bike tour around Australia.
And a year's supply of Oz Comfy Pads.
You'll need them.
Hey, Oz Comfy Pads, built tough for Aussie conditions.
From the top end of Tasmania, we've got you covered.
We've always found sex to be a bit of a giggle. I think it's really important to laugh during sex.
Our sex life's a joke.
My husband put beluga caviar in my navel and ate it out very, very slowly.
2 dozen oysters really puts us in the mood. It's amazing what you can do with fish fingers.
I believe in polygamy.
I think I believe in monogamy. I know I believe in vasectomy.
You know, we've all got our worries. I'm really worried tonight on just how tall the Ayatollah's TV antenna is, just between you and me. But we've all got worries. But there, I'd like to introduce you to a man who has more worries than anybody I've ever met. He's our first special guest on Tuesday Night Live, The Big Gig, and it gives me great pleasure to introduce Brian Doyle.
Bless you. I worry a lot. At the moment, my sort of major worry is this immigration debate. And I figured out a solution. What we should do is bring over 2 million Chinese people and build a city for them in North Queensland. And that could be the ultimate in multicultural relations. 2 million Chinese living on Aboriginal land and paying rent to the Japanese. I worried about the bicentennial. I mean, who can forget that great day in January when 2 million people crowded the Sydney foreshores as they stood there waiting, watching, wondering to see if Sir Frank would throw Lady Susan into the harbor or not. He didn't, unfortunately. He did disconnect her phone and she had no food. She said that was sad, wasn't it? In fact, her search for food became so desperate she sacked her solicitor and hired Bob Geldof. And then her and Sir Frank got together again, and God, we were all excited about that. It was a wonderful 12 minutes. And he called her his little American Express card. Not because she was expensive, but because he couldn't leave home without her. I can't wait until they turn her into a musical. Just to see Sir Frank, Andrew Peacock, and Robert Sangster standing there singing, "If You Knew Susie." Mind you, she's done well, God love her, hasn't she? $5 million in alimony, $5 million. She said, "I'd risk AIDS for that." I figured when Sangster gave her $5 million, he must have really loved her. And then last month, I read, he paid $14 million for a horse. And that was a gelding. Daylight saving, there's another one. Because when they put the clock forward, I thought to myself, I've lost an hour of my life. And they said, don't worry. Because eventually they put the clock back and you regain the hour. And then I thought, but what happens if I die in between? Does God owe me an hour? And I go up to heaven and I say, God, you owe me an hour. And God says, piss off, I'm from Queensland. I shouldn't say that about Queensland. It's a wonderful place. When I die, I'm going to live there. That way I can still vote. What an incredible man he was, Sir Joe. God, he's a powerful man. When he stands up, Toyotas jump in the air. He's now on the lecture circuit. He phoned up a speechwriter. He said, I asked for a 30-minute speech. It's taken me an hour to read it. And the writer said, I'm not surprised. I've given you two copies. And the Fitzgerald inquiry, there's another worry. God, those Queensland coppers, they're something else. They show The Godfather as a training movie. I saw the headlines of the Brisbane paper, $6 million marijuana bust, 5 police charged. I think the rest of them paid cash. What about Big Russ Hinge, accused of visiting a house of ill repute? All he was trying to do was squash prostitution. I don't know whether he got in for nothing, but I bet he got a group discount. And the Premier up there, Micah Hearn, he's worried as well. Because when the Fitzgerald findings are released, he's got to call a cabinet meeting. And by the look of it, there won't be enough of them out on parole. God, it's so Queensland, isn't it? $8 million in bribes, and they still can't win a Sheffield Shield. And what about that minister up there? Did you see that Don Lane? Have you seen the picture of his nose? Jeez, if he was into coke, he could swallow Tasmania. Accused of cheating on income tax. That's disgraceful, isn't it? People who cheat on income tax should be ashamed of ourselves. Listen, my major worry now is I've gone over time. So until I see you again, enjoy your worries.
Here's a late news update. Police have disclaimed responsibility for an accident in which the entire Aboriginal Cricket 11 was found hanged in the changing rooms of the MCG after rain stopped play during the friendly match against a combined police side. It's not the way we would have liked to have won, said the police captain, but that's the luck of the game. And we'll return to our programme in just a tick. Look, do you remember when variety meant variety? All those lovely slinky silk jersey dresses, Ave Maria, velvet jackets for the gentlemen, of course, the green, green grass of home, all rounded off with a marvellous hoedown or Oklahoma selections. It was such fun. Gone now. Gone like the yellow leaves of autumn.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I'd like to sing you a special love song now, but I don't know any. So I'd like you to help me out, please. I'd like you to tell me something you'd like me to sing in this love song. What would you like this love song to be about? Anything at all. It can be a person. Now you know it's live, don't you? Rent and Idiot's in. And anybody else? What else we have? Something interesting. Say it again.
Humphrey Bear.
Humphrey Bear. Now you really know it's live, don't you? All right. Humphrey Bear can be in this love. What else? Give me an emotion. I need an emotion.
Anger.
Anger, yes. An angry...
Jealousy.
Jealousy. All right. We'll have jealousy, because we're having all these written down on a bit of paper here, and whatever down on the bit of paper will be sung about in the song. Give me a place. I need a place.
Victoria.
Victoria, that's fine, okay. What else should we have? Is that the toilet or was that Victoria?
The toilet.
The toilet. Okay, we'll have Victoria and the toilet. Against the wall. She said, sneaking out of the studio. Against the wall. All right, we'll have against the wall. Give me something else. A vegetable, a famous person, anything you like.
Carrot.
A carrot. A carrot. It's the same girl sneaking out with a cucumber in her mouth. Okay, we got cucumbers, carrots, and give me something difficult. So, try and trip me up. Huh? Boils. Himalayas. Himalayas. Okay, so we have a love song about the Himalayas, a cucumber, carrot, Victoria, toilet, against the wall, the wall. Against the wall, carrot, Humphrey Bear, and jealousy. Okay. Oh, here we go, here we go.
To slice those carrots the way you used to slice them with a cucumber in your hair. I miss you, my friend. I miss you so much. You gone to the Himalayas to look for Humphrey Bear. Victoria. Everybody join in. All right. That is the first. I'm against the wall. Join in. I'm against the wall. I'm against the wall. I'm against the wall. In the toilet. In Victoria.
Thank you.
Another tune destined to be a hit there from Glenn. Well, that's about all from us tonight. What about, do you feel a bit of a conga coming on, gang? Yeah! Okay, let's conga out of here with Kenny Lopez, Sex Mambo. Let's do it!
One, two, three, four!
Tell the teacher what she saw! I go to the cinema. It resembles a chair, so I go sit in it. One day I went home, I looked out the kitchen window. I saw a little man dancing without a jumping in my yard. Who's that jumping in my yard?
Who's that gaga looking joker?
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 Come and jump into my arms.
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 Jumping in my yard.
Who's that jumping in my yard?